Thank you, Dr. Gordon, for that wonderful introduction, and thank all of you for being here today. When I thought about what to talk about this afternoon, I first thought I could take the easy way out and give one of my regular lectures like Boolean algebra or Kirchhoff's current law, or, okay, I can see that wouldn't have worked out. And then I thought about discussing some of my patents, a method and apparatus for indicating uncorrectable errors to a target, method and apparatus for mitigating noise in an output signal of an audio automatic gain control circuit, extension of wired controller area networks to wireless personal area networks. I thought about this for a while, and I figured my audience would probably end up like these guys. So rather than talk about my patents, I decided to focus on the lives and patents of a few very interesting inventors that have something to do with the music. I'm also a musician, so the first and most obvious one of my heroes here, Mr. Lester Polsfus, probably recognize him more by the name Les Paul. He's a very just incredible guitar player, but also a fantastic innovator and inventor as well. He was born in Waukesha, Wisconsin, and he was known as the Wizard of Waukesha. He left high school, left before he graduated, hit the road with a band, and started his musical career very early, but that didn't really keep him from becoming a very innovative inventor. He is credited with one of our earliest electric guitars and also is actually the main pioneer in the techniques that we use for recording music today. So I'll talk about that a little bit, the concept of multi-track recording. If we go back to the prior to Les Paul's time, the way they recorded bands and musicians is the entire band would get together in a room and they play the song and have the singer there and everything, and they'd mix all of the sources into one channel, a single channel tape. And so what you ended up with was, you know, what you got there, there was no way to go back and fix mistakes. If a single musician had made a mistake, everyone else was perfect, they'd all have to replay everything over again. If the mixing was done improperly, maybe the voice was too low or too loud, or a solo wasn't loud enough, they'd have to go back and readjust and redo all that. Well, in Les Paul's time, they started using what's called multi-track recording. And in this system, you have essentially a stack of individual heads on a tape that winds around that head. And so each source, each instrument or voice gets its own channel on that tape, and they're actually in synchronization on the tape. So if one person messes up, they don't all have to replay. He can just go back and redo his horn part or his vocal part, et cetera. And in addition to that, they can do mixing after the fact. They can take those individual channels and they can add reverb, they can add effects, they can adjust the levels, et cetera. Now, if you look through the web, there's a lot of people that'll say that Les Paul invented multi-track recording, and that's actually not the case. I found a patent going back to 1930 where actually a geologist invented multi-track recording. Just a minute here. A geologist invented it in order to record simultaneous data from seismographs at remote locations. But what Les Paul did do is he invented the concept of sound on sound, where we can listen to previously recorded tracks and then add additional tracks to it. And I'll give you a little bit of a sound bite here. Thank you. So there are actually only two musicians playing on that song, Les Paul and Mary Ford. And there's 12 tracks of Mary Ford's voice and 12 tracks of Les Paul's guitar. When he started doing this, he kind of kept it a secret. And listeners were just amazed to hear multiple versions of Mary Ford harmonizing with herself on the same song. They thought she was some kind of crazy singer. So anyway, the cat got out of the bag eventually. And of course, nowadays, we use that concept in all of our recordings. And also, of course, nowadays, rarely do we use tape anymore. It's all done in a computer, but the concept is still the same. This is a picture of Les Paul's guitar patent. And another, a little more detailed picture shows his picture of the pickup. If you take a close look up there, you can see there's a coil of wire exposed, and that's one of the components of the pickup system. Since this is an educational talk somewhat, I'll talk a little bit about how a magnetic pickup works. So it starts with a permanent magnet, which generates a magnetic field. Now, if something metallic goes into that field, it's going to cause a disturbance in the field. If we insert a coil of wire in that field, it'll pick up those fluctuations. And so if you can imagine, this is a guitar string vibrating through the magnetic field, causing these fluctuations, and it's being converted into an electrical signal, which we can then later amplify. The original version of the pickup, I shouldn't even call it a pickup, it was a microphone that Les Paul used. As the story goes, when he was 13 or 14, he'd go out to the local drive-in, and he'd bring his acoustic guitar and play and sing. And a lot of people told him that, well, we can hear your voice just fine, but we can't hear what you're doing on the guitar. So he went and got his parents' telephone and radio, and he used the microphone part off the telephone and hooked that up to his guitar, and he used the radio as the amplifier. I'm sure his mom and dad were not too happy about that. But that was his start. And of course, that's fairly limited because the sound quality is very poor, and it's going to pick up a lot of feedback and whatnot. And that's what led him to his invention of the magnetic pickup. This is a picture of the famous log guitar. Not his original prototype, but one of the earlier ones. This is his third or fourth guitar. And the center beam that you see there is actually made from a piece of standard pine construction lumber. The two sides are not really needed. They're just there to make it look like more like a guitar. This is the instrument that he worked with Gibson on to perfect the guitar that goes by his name, the Gibson Les Paul guitar, which is very popular guitar. Played by many notable guitarists, including Ace Frehley, George Harrison, Eric Clapton, Slash, the Allman Brothers, Peter Frampton, and then that guy up there. I got to go off the topic a little bit here to tell you a story about that guitar. It has a very interesting distinction. I bought that instrument in 1990, and about a month after I purchased it, we had a tornado come through and level our house. We discovered that guitar about 2 miles from the house, stuck headfirst in a cornfield. And luckily it was in its case, but the neck had still broken off. Fortunately, I was able to have a luthier reattach the neck, and it's good as new. So I think I can brag. I'm pretty sure I'm the only one that owns a Gibson Les Paul Custom that has taken a ride on an F6 Tornado. So let's hear a little bit more of Les Paul's fantastic guitar picking here. Thank you. good stuff. Okay, inventor number two is Lawrence Hammond. He's the only degreed person that I'm going to talk about today. He got his degree from Cornell, and he's got a lot of legends attached with his career as well. One of those is that he was actually studying mechanical engineering and went in to take the final exam and passed the electrical engineering final exam. So it's debatable whether he's actually a mechanical engineer or an electrical engineer, but he is amazingly prolific, as I said there. He was born in Evanston, near Chicago. His early years were not real happy. His father passed away when he was very young. His mother and he moved to France, where she thought it would be a little less expensive to live. While there, Larry invented a mechanism for automatically shifting an automobile. And he presented this invention to French automakers at the age of 12. And of course, they were very impressed, but didn't think there'd be a market for an automatic transmission. So he didn't make any money on that deal. They did move back to the Evansville area, and he did have some financial success with this idea. This is a barometer, very simple and inexpensive, and it became a very popular instrument among science teachers for their science labs and things like that. And he sold this for $300. He was 16 years old at the time, and that $300 is equivalent to about $7,500 today. So not too bad for a 16-year-old. He went and served in World War I, and upon his return, of course, was wanting to start another business. And I find it really interesting that at the time, you know, it was the 1920s, we had AM radio, we had FM radio, TV was just getting started, but people were all still using wind-up clocks. And so Larry invented one of the first electric clocks, and I brought one here to show you. This is a Hammond clock. This is a 1929. And along with his invention of the clock, he invented the motor to make the hands move, of course. So the clock business did fairly well. Larry continued to dabble in interesting innovations. One of those was a stereoscopic viewing device for movies so that you could see movies in 3D. It was very complicated. He did sell this to a couple of theaters, but the mechanical linkages and all that were just overly complicated, impossible to maintain and operate. So that idea was abandoned. But that led him to something that we've all seen, we all still use again today, those little red and green 3D glasses for 3D viewing. He worked on a film series called The Ziegfeld Follies. And for that work, and the 3D glasses, et cetera, he earned $75,000, equivalent to $1 million in today's money. And I want to just note here, our third inventor also worked in the Ziegfeld Follies movies, but in a little bit different role. So the Hammond Company was very successful, but along comes the Great Depression. And it was very difficult to keep a company going during those times. And Larry was determined to keep the company out of bankruptcy. So he worked very hard over the course of 3 or 4 years to come up with other ideas, something other than this clock idea. And he realized that he could use his motors to generate tones. So if you take a look up here, the tone wheel works on the same principle as the guitar pickup. We still have a permanent magnet, we still have a coil of wire, but instead of a vibrating string, we now have a rotating wheel. That wheel has teeth on it, and so the tone that is generated depends on how fast the wheel is rotating and the number of teeth on the wheel. So you get something like this for a single tone wheel. Larry adopted this idea to create his Hammond organ. I'm sure you've probably all heard of the Hammond organs. And this is an exposed view of the inside of one of those organs showing the tone wheels, the many tone wheels that you'd need for all the different tones that are on one of those organs. And so they marketed this as a pipe organ without pipes. And it was a very attractive item for smaller schools and small churches that could not afford a large pipe organ, or they didn't have the room to house one of those gigantic things. So once again, the company did very well for quite some time, and then World War II came along. And so once again, with all the rationing and people going off to the war, the company was on the verge of bankruptcy. And however, a high-ranking naval official decided it would help the morale of the soldiers to have music aboard the ships. And they consequently ordered 500 or 1,500 units in like 1940-something. So that put the company back on solid ground. And one of his legacies is the Hammond B3 organ, which is the sound of Motown, essentially, but also found its way into rock and pop music. Anybody want to guess who that was? Santana, very good. The song? Evil Ways, you're right. Okay. Well, and on to our third and our final inventor. And, of course, her story involves the most intrigue. Hedwig, Eva Maria Kiesler. Obviously, for good reason, changed her name to Hedy. In Hollywood, her name's Hedy Lamarr. She, at the time, was considered one of the most beautiful women in Hollywood. She was born in 1913 in Vienna and was a very successful actress. Had a lot of movies, including her original film, Ecstasy, and the Ziegfeld Follies films. Over the course of her life, she had six husbands, first one being a weapons dealer to the Nazi Party. Her patent secret communication system is probably used by all of us today, and you don't know it. You will in a few minutes. So this very first film was done in 1933 in Czechoslovakia, and I will limit what I say to that it was a very risque film. Had to be extensively edited in order to be shown in the U.S. At that time, she was married to Fritz Mandl, and he was an arms dealer for Hitler and Mussolini. And I should say, just so you don't go away with a bad idea of him, once he found out what they were up to, he abandoned that business and fled the country as well. So, but while she was married to Fritz, she had the opportunity to attend all of these meetings and dinners, etc., where all these high-ranking military officials would gather, and they would discuss the kind of problems that they were having with weaponry and with controlling torpedoes, etc. And so she was able to listen in on all of these conversations. Eventually, again, she grew tired of her husband's domineering nature, disguised herself as a maid, and fled the country, and ended up in Hollywood, where she became a very successful actor.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, moving up to about 1940, she became friends with a guy named George Ann Thiel, who was a famous composer at that time. And one of the things that he was famous for was some pretty outlandish compositions in which he would synchronize multiple player pianos so that you could have a lot of different parts playing at the same time. During that time, she was considering retiring from her acting career to pursue some of her invention ideas. And the legend has it that they were playing this game on the piano where George would play a sequence of notes on the lower octave. And then Hetty would respond with the same notes sequence on a higher octave. So keep that in mind as we talk about one of the issues that was facing the military at that time. It was called jamming. What they did back then is the ship that's launching a torpedo would attempt to control the direction of the torpedo using a radio frequency wave. And what would happen was the launching ship would control this torpedo, but then the enemy, because it was just a single frequency wave, the enemy could listen in with special equipment, know what frequency they're transmitting the control signal on, generate the same frequency at a higher level, and what that does, it essentially jams the original control signal, causing the torpedo to lose control and miss the target. So that's what they call jamming. And Hetty and George thought, well, if we could change that frequency repetitively, not stay on a constant frequency, jump back and forth to different frequencies, then the enemy would not be able to detect our frequency. So it went something like this. Like this. Okay. This is known as frequency hopping because you're changing frequencies. Now, in order for this concept to work, the transmitter and receiver obviously have to change in unison. They have to change at the same time or they'll lose track of each other. This is the original patent by Hetty and George. And what it shows is the transmitting and receiving units of this new control system whereby they're using piano rolls to change the frequency of both the transmitter and the receiver. A piano roll, for those of you who don't know, a long roll of paper with holes punched in it, and those sequences of holes determine which key is going to be played on the piano. In this application, rather than using it to choose keys on a piano, they're using the sequences of punched holes to choose which frequency the oscillator generates or looks for in the receiver. Now, it's a great idea, but the reality of trying to make this work with a piano roll was a little bit far-fetched because, for one thing, the motors that are turning those rolls would have to spin at precisely the same speed. They'd have to start at precisely the same time. So, for the technology they had back in the 40s, this was almost impossible to do. In addition to that, when they proposed this to the Navy, you know, it just didn't sit right with them to think about having piano rolls in one of their torpedoes. You know, it just didn't sound right. So, it was not adopted at the time. But in the late 80s and early 90s, of course, our electronics advanced to the state where we could actually implement this idea. And of course, frequency hopping, which we now know as also as spread spectrum technology, is used in many cell phones, including this one. This is the original Nextel prototype phone, which was developed in 1994 and 95. And of course, this uses spread spectrum technology, as do most of our cell phones today. And again, frequency hopping is used in satellites and in secure military communication systems as well. So, we've learned about three very important inventors today, and I guess to summarize it a little bit here, with Larry Hammond's ideas, we can get up early in the morning. With Hedy Lamarr's invention, we can talk on our cell phones all day. And with the brilliance of Les Paul, we can rock and roll all night long. Thank you. And I believe there are, if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. But if not, there's goodies outside. Yes?
You could have chosen any number of inventors. Why those three?
Because I wanted to tie it into my interest as a musician, because I am a guitar player. So, and I had always known about, of course, Les Paul as, you know, being a guitar player. And I had known about Hedy Lamarr since I started teaching here, and I had an electronics communications class that I taught, and I always, you know, had that story. Larry Hammond, I wasn't aware of his genius until I started doing the research.
Paul, what was the first 8-track?
Probably Aerosmith, Toys in the Attic. I think that came out when I was in 8th grade. Fortunately, they were stolen when I was a junior in high school, all of my 8-tracks. And whoever stole them, I hope they're still enjoying them. No, I did not bring a guitar. That would have been too much pressure. That's right. But it's kind of a different situation. That's right. They're drinking. Yeah, okay. That's one important factor. Any other questions? Okay. Oh. We didn't know about that because it's classified, right? Not anymore. Yes? My last patent, okay, I'll give you a really brief overview. In our automobiles, we all have a network, and it's called controller area network. Okay. It was developed by a German company named Bosch in the 80s, and it pretty much, I'd say by now, it's on just about every car. The base network is called controller area network. There are a number of different variations based on which country the car is manufactured in, and that's a wired network. And like I said, it's in automobiles, but it's also in things like elevators, medical instrumentation, et cetera. And the reason is because it is a network which we call a deterministic network. Okay, I don't want to get too involved here, but deterministic basically means you can predict exactly how long it's going to take you to send a message on that network, okay, which is not the case for Ethernet. You know, for Ethernet, it's more or less a probability problem. Anyway, so there's this deterministic network that runs in all of our automobiles and other places. And what my patent does is it matches up with that wired network, a new wireless network standard that was developed in 2004 and 2005. And so what that allows us to do is to have access to that automotive network via this wireless network, which is also deterministic. So it's kind of like Wi-Fi for cars. That's probably the easiest way to say it. Thank you for asking. I hope I didn't bore you too much with that. But we, yes. The two Motorola patents that I hold, one involves changing automatically the levels of the sound that you hear. Prior to that patent, when you'd make a call, now keep in mind, when you make a call on your cell phone, you're not calling straight from your phone to another phone. You're going to the tower, maybe to another tower, you're going to a base station, you're going to the regular phone system, so you're hitting a lot of different nodes before your voice finally ends up at the other person's phone. Because of that, there's a lot of level variations that can occur as that's happening. And so one of those patents involves maintaining a consistent level to the listener for that audio that's going through the cell phone. The other one, the uncorrectable errors one, let's see. Do we all have a flat screen TV now, digital TV? You may have noticed that when a signal gets weak on a digital TV, it'll start pixelating and the picture will look funny and things like that. Well, with digital cell phones, the same thing happens, except you don't see it, you just hear it. So when the signal strength drops and you have a lot of errors in the audio stream, you end up with these really weird sounding things that we used to call golly wobbles back when I worked at Motorola. So essentially, you just hear this. And so the second patent there that looks at the data, decides if the errors are uncorrectable, and essentially eliminates the golly wobbles. So that's the golly wobble detector. No, it just mutes the speaker instead of having the weird sounds. Yes? Well, my wireless is not Bluetooth, first of all. My wireless network that I use is called Zigbee. But there's a distinct difference between the three wireless networks, okay? They're really made for different purposes. Your Wi-Fi is made for transferring large amounts of data as you're, surfing the internet, et cetera. Bluetooth is essentially made as a wire replacement for streaming audio to your Bluetooth headphones, et cetera. And Zigbee, which is the commercial name for that 802.15.4 number you heard earlier, that's made specifically for control purposes. So it's designed to do things like to work in like household automation and industrial automation to be a very robust and reliable network. Yes. Mm-hmm. In fact, they might be paying Motorola to use that. I don't know. Anything else? All right. Well, thank you very much again. Don't forget about the goodies.
I want to congratulate Dr. Kuban as well, on his work and for
thank you.
Doing a great job, being a great ambassador for our university.
Well, thank you very much.
We have some refreshments outside, and there's a cake out there. So if you don't eat the cake, he has to take it home. So please eat the goodies out there as well. But thank you. Okay.
You're very welcome. Yeah.